Good evening. I'd like to open the planning board meeting for January the 14th. Thank you. And tonight we don't have projects, but just to give you a heads up on the agenda, we'll be taking public comment if there is any, but no one's here tonight, so we don't expect any. And we'll be discussing changes to the zoning map of urban residential A category. And we received a briefing from a housing build-out analysis. I forget the name of the company that did
Agora
that.
Agora Partners.
Agora Partners. And we'd like to discuss that. We received that in December. And then there's a topic of wayfinding for active living, the bike ped plan, which is a subcommittee to the planning board, climate adaptation update, and then there are two projects that Carolyn's bringing to us that are A&Rs, which are not for us to actually vote on, but to confirm that she can handle those projects. And then we'll do the minutes. And also I'd like to go around and very quickly, because I do expect we'll have time tonight, to get each of you to give me a one-liner on the committee, your collateral subcommittee that you work with. So with that, Carolyn, I think that clears public comment. And
wait, the public.
Wayne may have
the public
comment. There you go. So turn it over to you to talk about URA.
Education, okay. Housing, land.
So it's probably been close to 2 years now since we, or maybe just a year, seems like a long time ago, that we talked about a map change for urban residential A. So this was coming on the heels of all the changes that you all worked on for the residential district, the core residential districts, for A, B, and C, but really focused on modifications to the B and C district. And as part of that process, you heard from the public that, and also it's going all the way back to Sustainable Northampton, was looking at whether or not the urban residential A district made sense as it stood. Are there map changes that might be appropriate? Given the geographic locations of some of those districts. So after that, we went through the map and we talked about what made sense for those districts. And we sort of came up with a plan for conducting a public process to start the conversation about map changes. We had a number of zoning changes and other issues that came up that sort of kept bumping that conversation down the road. So this is an opportunity to bring that back to the forefront, talk about what the steps are, and make sure we've had changes to the board, so bring new members up to speed on those discussions, and also have the discussion again, does the board still feel like it makes sense to pursue map changes to some of these districts. So that's really the point of this conversation. And I sent out the map, I guess it was just today, but I have it on the board here, lots of bright colors, but I wanted to get the A out there as to make that punch as much as possible, so that dark purple is the urban A district throughout the city. So I can zoom in on this map up on the screen, but you also have the map in front of you that you might be able to, I didn't put a lot of legend markers on it, but just sort of street names. And then to give a context, I put lot lines on there so you can kind of see the size of lots for each of the districts. So I thought it would make sense to start from one end of the city and move to the next to make sure to understand what the board's feelings are about those proposed changes. And I can go over sort of where we last left off to start that. But I think what I'll do is move over here to the eastern edge.
Could I ask you to do one more thing? Would you give us a sort of thumbnail characterization of the different districts that are that we're talking about?
Sure.
So it's obviously A we're talking about, but then, you know, what is it that distinguishes A from B?
Right.
Which colors are which?
Yeah. So, and the reason why I also have on this quick map the all these other colors are to really show the context and the adjacencies of these districts. Urban, and so in terms of urban residential districts, if you look on the map, and I wish we could, I think we need a better pointer, but I'm just going to use my cursor now. But sort of on the right, lower right corner, there's a dark red. And the dark red are the commercial districts. I didn't differentiate between central business, highway business, and entrance business. I just put them all as red. But if you go to the sort of the lower right corner where you've got more of a red circular pattern, that's central business district, and the orange around that is urban residential C. That's our most dense residential district, and it's the boundaries are approximately a half mile from the outer edge, half mile in some cases it's much closer, maximum from downtown. So that's where we allow multifamilies. The heights go up to 55 feet. And so that goes, that extends out on the west. It goes out Elm Street, the dark orange, up to Round Hill. And then out to the Mill River, basically Green Street neighborhood. And a lot of Smith Campus is actually, the underlying district is urban residential C. So those neighborhoods off of next to Paradise Road. So I think half of Kensington is actually urban residential C. Then on the east side of downtown, Market Street, North Street, all the way to the Bridge Street Cemetery, and then down Pomeroy Terrace. And it cuts off pretty, it borders the Special Conservancy floodplain, the Meadows, on the far eastern side. So where it turns white there on the edge, that drops dramatically down to the Meadows. And then the yellow on the other edge of that, or surrounding that, going all the way out to Florence, is urban residential B. We allow up to three families by right, but also townhouse units that are attached or detached. You just approved in the last month or so that project on Barrett Street that was 23 townhouse units. That's in the urban residential B district. So that goes, that sort of, that covers all the way up to and surrounding Florence Center, which is the other red, almost circular blob in the sort of center of the map, is Main Street of Florence and the little spur streets that feed into that, Maple Street and Chestnut, bits of those streets, the southern ends where it touches Main Street. And then those neighborhoods north and south of Florence Center, all the way up to Bridge Road, basically, is urban residential B, except for the dark purple, which is urban residential A. And urban residential A only allows single family homes and accessory apartments. So no two families, no three families. And it's sort of, it is the least dense of the more urban neighborhoods. So, and then beyond that, the light blues are the water supply protection, which has resource drinking water supply constraints. And that's where we have larger lots that are, even though some of these are grandfathered, you can see these smaller lots in the light blue. It's really meant to be an area where we don't want to encourage new development because of the drinking water supply. And then the light yellows and the greens are either protected lands or rural or more suburban areas, sort of further out and not walkable to Florence Center or downtown. And the lot sizes are, the lot size requirements are require much larger frontage, bigger frontage, and lot size. So when, if you recall, when we went to, went through the rezoning of A, B, and C districts, there was a period of time where we were trying to grapple with what we name them. Can we name them something else that means what they are? And it was very hard to come up with a name, particularly for the A district, because there's nothing that really ties it all together and says, this is what this wants to be, or this is the defining characteristic of this type of district. And, you know, I think people could make arguments about the B and C, but it'd be easier to I think, define urban residential C as really surrounding downtown Northampton is our densest neighborhood. So I think it'd be easier to make that, to make a case for a name that really describes that. So the purple, which is the urban residential A, is sort of sprinkled in some cases right in the middle. And as you get around the Round Hill area, if you see the, I don't know if you can tell Round Hill, but it's sort of that the circular two roads that go, that straddle B and C district, and then there's those purple splotches right in the middle. And the same for along the Mill River, just south of there, south of Elm Street, where there's just a little pocket of A, but it's completely surrounded by B. It's walkable to schools in downtown and Smith College.
So did these originally, these zones kind of arose out of identifying what we had and kind of drawing a circle around what we had and then kind of labeling it?
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to the 1975.
Right.
And I think there was a little bit of that, and Wayne probably has more history. I think there's a little bit of trying to define what it looked like and then create rules about that for moving forward in the future. And then there was probably a little bit of pushback saying, well, we know we're like that, but we don't want to be like that in the future, is what I imagine. I mean, I obviously wasn't here then, but it's hard to explain otherwise.
I think that's right, that the uses reflected what was there in 75 without a lot of vision, mm-hmm. but the dimensional was actually stricter. They in 75, they created enormous neighborhoods which said your lots should be bigger than they are. So in some cases, 50% of the lots didn't meet the zoning requirements.
But they were built on. It was lots that were platted and built on.
Yeah. Right.
In the past few years, we've looked at different zones and we've tried to define what you can and can't do, what makes sense to do or not do in those zones. Are we now trying to step back and you see, for instance, little pockets of purple and a sea of yellow, trying to streamline the different zones so it physically makes sense? Or
so it physically makes sense, and so there's a consistent vision for what it is out there. I mean, it's not so much about cleaning up the map, making it look pretty. It's that, you know, Round Hill is a good example. There's no logic in this split.
Right.
It goes from URC to URA.
Right.
And I don't know why. That doesn't fit what happened to me in 74. It was different.
Right.
But, you know, some of the most expensive neighborhoods in the city are URC on the east side of Round Hill. Mm-hmm. And then they're actually less, it's still expensive on the west side, but it's not like they're that wanted bigger lots than the
right.
other. There wasn't really logic there.
You wonder about the one north of Florence Center too, that dips way into the yellow.
Right.
That one at least was not as old a development. That's Fox Farms, mm-hmm. and that was not newer, but it was a 50s development, and so that was less dense than the yellow area.
Well, and some of that, I think there were covenants at the time the subdivision was
yeah.
created that they could only have single family homes,
mm-hmm. right.
so then the zoning kind of matched what the private developer decided what he wanted to build. And yet, I don't think that's consistent with where we are now as a city saying, well, this is where we have built infrastructure, and if it's possible to, you know, allow more units in that type of location, doesn't it make sense to have the zoning match what the vision is for the city?
And part of that vision is the walkability. So, you know, that people will happily walk 6 cents a mile and sometimes as far as a mile, and so we should be, you know, from the villages and downtown, we should be encouraging those to be denser. So if URA doesn't make sense because it's denser sort of from, you know, just north of Florence to downtown, going further west, it may not make sense for the opposite reason. If we're trying to say that that shouldn't be a lot of development, some of those things probably should be downzoned.
But, I mean, isn't there, especially, I mean, you're right, especially the one around Round Hill seems to be the most, but that also means on the other side, it's going to be the most dramatic, potentially the most dramatic impact on that particular neighborhood.
So it depends on the approach.
If you change it.
If you change what URA is, that's true. There may be some place that makes sense to rezone it instead. So Round Hill might make sense to go to URB. So it might still be a URA that's much, I mean, there's a few different approaches. One to get rid of URA totally and move things either to URB on one side or to suburban residential on the other. The other approach is just to move some of them. It doesn't make sense. So it certainly doesn't, whatever you do, it doesn't have to be universal across the board.
Right. So, and I think after the last conversation, the last exercise that the board had around this, we sort of looked at each of these pockets and said, well, this makes sense, so let's take the Round Hill one. That makes sense to, I think it was to go to URB, or to suggest that it goes to URB. And same for Ward Avenue. But there was this, in the neighborhood in Leeds, which is, I have to go up, it's on the upper left, maybe leave at URA because there isn't really any other URB beyond, this might not have printed up there and I can't pull up my GIS, but I think, so that was one example in Leeds. I remember that that neighborhood, Front Street and North going up to Evergreen was, maybe just leave that as URA, but a lot of these other ones that were closer in and along the bike path or accessible to the bike path, remap to URB. And then there's this over on the southwest bordering the water supply protection where we're not trying to encourage development. The reason why we have these strange little pockets there is just because of the topographic break for the water supply and the drainage area. So it wouldn't really make sense to go to B or some more dense zone in that district, but maybe go even less dense. Mm-hmm. Right. So, and I apologize, I thought in this printout, it's on the bigger map, but when I made a PDF, it looks like it cut off a portion of that Leeds neighborhood. That continues.
It's right up there at the top.
Yeah.
And that's currently A?
Uh-huh.
So the purple continues out.
Yeah, north of, we're off the cutoff. If you kept going north off the sheet. The Chesterfield Road area, probably we don't have water and sewer out there, so that probably makes sense to go to down zone as opposed to keeping that at A. So, you know, I guess I'm just bringing this to you to see if you have any thoughts about that. You know, we could start at Round Hill. Well, let me just start way east on Damon Road. I think the conversation was at that point, there's a little strip there, which is very strange. It straddles. It backs up to I-91 and then also to the river. And we have this whole reconstruction of Damon Road going on. I think the conversation was just leave it as it is now because we should really wait to see how that all plays out. We don't want to change it to potentially commercial unless we have some kind of agreements about access because, you know, building a brand new road, we don't want to all of a sudden open that up for, you know, it really affect the overall goal of trying to make that corridor improve. Throughput and as well as bicycle amenities.
So who makes the final call on what changes occur?
So this would be an ordinance change, and the planning board would recommend the changes. It would go through the same ordinance process that text changes go through. And so ultimately, city council would vote to approve or not any of the map changes. And so it would be introduced to city council, then referred back out for public hearing with both the planning board and then city council subcommittee, which I don't recall the new name of that committee, would have a public hearing, and it would then ultimately go back to city council for a vote. And if you, some of you may not know this, but during the whole conversation about changes to B, A, B, and C, there were residents in the B and C district that felt like we were not also addressing urban residential A, and there was a strong sentiment that the city really need to reevaluate some of these in-town A districts so that we're sort of sharing the wealth of where infill can occur.
But so, you know, there was, when this was proposed before for parts of this, there's a lot of pushback as well. So just, if this goes forward, make sure you're ready for that.
Yeah. Sure.
Looking at, go up there to that triangular one that sort of seems to be pointing at the one that's north of the Florence.
Right here? Oh, up here.
Yeah, half of that is platted heavily, and half of it's totally open, seems to be totally open. And it's like that on a lot of those. What kinds of changes, if you alter these, what kinds of changes would it permit in terms of altering the density? I mean, that's true for any of these things.
Right.
I think that's a question that you have
is
to
Is that consider. Where well, JFK is?
Yeah. Oh. So that one large parcel is JFK. The other one is Bear Hill. So those...
Which doesn't show.
Right.
Well, because there are no property boundaries.
Yeah.
It's just one parcel.
Yeah.
So both of those are essentially built out.
But there must be others, or maybe they are also.
Talking, so, right.
So this would be the
about
VA.
That's a park.
Park
but I was,
then,
you know, and like over here, for instance. I mean, there's.
Well, and I think the other piece of Look Park, we talked for Look Park about Look Park specifically to rezoning that to farms, forests, and rivers, which is the zone we've applied to publicly owned
open space.
Open space, yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. And just so that it just to get at your point is it's not, we're not anticipating that it's going to be developed. This is a park and it's going to remain a park.
There might be some text changes.
So that's not true of Charles Park.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, would you do the same thing with Charles Park?
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, the way you view it, if you got the, if you got rid of those kinds of things.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we would also have to make, as Wayne mentioned, text changes to the Farms, Forests, Rivers zone because it specifically says now city-owned parcels. And so these are sort of
quasi-public.
But they're meant to be permanently protected. So we just need to make that parallel change.
Just clear, using Charles Park example, it does include what looks like that purple triangle actually includes both sides of Woodlawn. So obviously there would be 15 homes who would have a lot of
Well, it, yeah, and that's, it would be so much clearer if that sort of thing were identified rather than,
right.
So the changes that were made with the whole infill ideas are apply to which zones?
Well, the orange is urban residential C. So we've made a lot of dimensional changes to urban residential C. We also, at the same time, made dimensional changes to the bright gold, which is urban residential B, reduced the frontage and the lot size.
The bright, you mean the
yellow.
Yellow.
The yellow.
Yeah. Okay. And we also made dimensional changes to A, but the change that wasn't made was allowing more than a single family home.
So you've shrunken the lot size requirement for all those.
Right. But not the allowance for more than one unit in the A district. So this is really a conversation about allowing, a two-family in those purple districts as opposed to just a restriction to single-family.
Which is why it's not going to have a huge effect. because, you know, there's not a huge market demand for the two families, but it, you know, it gives people options.
I mean, you could almost go to the point where anything close to downtown, the purple areas should go to B, and everything on the outlining areas, including the parks, would go to a restricted, and you don't end up with any URA anywhere.
When we looked at it, that worked everywhere but Leeds. That Leeds may not want to be that much more dense, mm-hmm. but they don't want to be that much less dense either. Mm-hmm. And again, from my standpoint, I mean, you know, I like the map looking pretty and being easy. Not to look pretty, but to tell an easy story.
Right.
But that's fine if Leeds is your. I mean, I like saying half a mile from downtown is
right.
URC.
Right, and, right.
Yeah. But so Leeds maybe makes sense to be the only URA.
Right.
That's okay. So is most of the pushback that this board has received in the past primarily due to that lot size or allowing additional multifamilies?
Because it's those kind of people, is literally what we heard.
What's that?
It was those kinds of people. Those are different kinds of people than we have here.
Right.
Well, and I think to answer Dan's original question, what would happen, we would have public hearings about this. I mean,
right.
that's, mm-hmm. we will.
I'm just wondering where the.
And we did last time, it was much more limited. It was really just St. James and that area, you know, the part that Ward Avenue and St. James, and then Hillside, right? Is that the ones we looked at? Or did we do Woodlawn as well last time?
Well, Hillside, I think Langworthy, too.
Langworthy, right.
Yeah, which is that little L-shaped purple by Round Hill.
But we weren't talking any of the other purples at the time.
But I think I agree with Mark, but, I mean, I think I would, yeah. You could take all of these purple ones kind of before you get the Leeds and convert them, and especially the ones that are, you know, essentially completely surrounded by B.
Yeah.
So B allows up to three families, is that right?
Right.
And A is just singles plus a mother-in-law apartment
right.
or whatever, mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
And there are even
in
some of
these.
Is there
anything for two families, or it has to go one all the way to three, basically?
Well, we just made that change for B. But it's also based on lot size. If you don't have a big enough lot size, or you can't meet the open space. You can't do two
right.
families, or you can't
right.
do a three family. So it's not that it all of a sudden means that every single lot has the option of going up to three.
And when you look at these, from what you know of these,
right.
how much, what particular places and how much do you think the possibility is? Because in some of these places, it looks to me as if there'd be no possibility in practically the whole segment.
Yeah, I mean, the ones, I think there are probably some twos and maybe even threes around Washington Avenue that exist now in the urban residential A district. And there are some larger homes there that potentially could be converted. So you could create a unit
mm-hmm.
within the structure.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that allows the person flexibility. If they buy into this larger home and they can no longer maintain it, or they don't want to, or... you know, job status changes, what have you, it provides for that opportunity.
What I was driving this is that our family size continues to drop.
Yes, it does.
And so we just have, you know, we're losing, but it's not so much we're trying to gain population in these areas, we're really trying to stem the loss of population.
But the other side of that is, too, is that the population is also aging.
Right.
And so having, you know, having options,
right.
you know, I mean, and the folks we work with, you know, same in Berkshire is here, I mean, people can't handle their home. I mean, but if they had an option to say something that could create income, that could stay in their home, you know, someone can blow the yard. I mean, it does. I mean, I think Carolyn's, you know, that to me, it creates options that you
mm-hmm.
wouldn't have otherwise, that you could then stay in your home.
Mm-hmm. The only thing I'm thinking, and everyone knows here, I'm a huge fan of density. but like the only thing that kind of jumps to mind for me in terms of physical geography is the Ward Ave and the Woodlawn and right adjacent
mm-hmm.
to the park because those areas are undeveloped. So in some ways it seems like a gentler transition to go from the river and the park to at least one street buffer of something that's a little bit less dense before getting to B.
I mean, I guess I would argue though that those lots are pretty similarly sized, except for the ones right on the river, but you can't build back there because it drops down to the floodplain.
Right.
And there are homes that already have, you know, there's a sprinkling of two units in there. So
definitely.
It's not really that dissimilar.
Right. Even though, I mean, I don't think it's dissimilar. I'm just saying, like, physical proximity to where there's no development at all. Like, because it's the last parcel before no development, is that an appropriate zone for that space that's physically next to the park or next to the river? I mean, or the I was on everything C, but, you know, that's...
But, like, the backs are, like, the... So Woodlawn, which is adjacent to Child's Park,
right.
Those are pretty big lots and some big houses, but the backside of Woodlawn is Massasoit, which also has, you know, a lot of those same big lots and big houses. So it's very similar.
Right.
And then on the other side, you've got Prospect Street, and that's all, you know, that's all developed fully with the streets behind it as well.
Busy street.
Right.
Yeah, I don't see a need for, like, a transition there.
I mean, outside of the fact that it would look pretty.
I mean, that's the other piece. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of where I'm coming from. Like, what's the least jarring, you know, kind of geographically as you're walking that neighborhood? Is there some reason? And I don't know that there is or isn't. I'm just throwing it out there. There may be some rationale for maintaining some kind of transition.
Mm. I mean, to me, I'm always pushing for more design control, and I think that's the bigger piece. I think you're right. You wouldn't necessarily want the park to be looking at ugly units. I don't think anyone's going to do ugly units there given the cost of the land, but if you're going to do anything, it might be go to URB and think about are there design issues to deal with that.
Right. Okay.
One thing where I thought you were going with that is it's hard when you're looking at a map like this to think about the topography.
Right.
Yeah. So when you've got Round Hill or you've got those lots on Ward Avenue that drop off, you've got a large lot, but you don't have a large building envelope.
Right. Right.
So I don't, but that doesn't hold on the other side of Prospect, and so that's not the whole story, but there are a couple of these pockets that I think are driven by that.
Mm-hmm. I could do a different line, incidentally, of, and I'm fine with everything in the middle being yellow, so I'm not arguing against it, but just in terms of sort of thinking out loud. The area sort of up to Woodlawn is the area that's walkable from downtown, long walk, but walkable from downtown. And that's the area where, to me, the density is most important. And so if I was doing a priority piece, it would be sort of Woodlawn into town, get rid of the purples there, and make them yellow.
Except that, I mean, that might be, I think that makes sense on the one hand. On the other hand, if you're going to make changes where there's some angst about it, you might just want to do it all together.
Right. Uniformly.
Right.
Yeah. Instead of breaking it up into...
Right.
Well, the whole question of spot zoning kind of comes into that too, doesn't it? I mean,
well, it's not
if
legal.
You leave a little bit of something someplace...
Yeah, but if you were... where the line is, how far out you go, there's no legal question. From a good planning standpoint, you may be right, but there's certainly no legal challenge.
Yeah.
It there's certainly going to be pushback no matter what we do. But at the same time, you could argue, if anybody's really listening, that if the parks went restricted, the purple in Leeds stayed, everything west of Leeds went blue, and everything else down closer to downtown went to yellow, that makes sense, you know, because most of the purple, all of the purple close to downtown is surrounded by yellow or orange, and it's not going to go business, it'll go B. And then Leeds up there, we want less development. It makes sense to keep that Leeds pocket. I don't think that would be an easier argument to sell.
Yep, I agree.
Yeah. Easier than just doing little pieces of it and sort of gerrymandering a little.
Right, or leaving for whatever drives us to leave a pocket of purple, or to listen to the Round Hill Road people say, not those people. And you could say, well, look where you are, look where your little pocket is, look at the map, it doesn't make sense.
What's the, and it's not up there, but what's this What's this purple here?
So that's one of those that's abuts the topographic shift in the water supply boundary. Mm-hmm. So we would recommend that that go to less dense because we're not trying
because
to
that looks
density out there.
That seems to make less sense than some of
right.
Yeah,
it's actually
right.
Backland.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There is one piece that I think internally we've had a conversation because this piece has been on the market, but there is a purple here. Right at the corner of Carlin Drive and Barrett Street. And it's so that may not be such an easy one either. We've talked about.
So, excuse me, where as you
where is it going?
Drive to Barrett? It's on the left.
It's on the left. And so it's between Carlin Drive and the marsh. Yeah.
Right, okay.
And it's residential across the street.
Yeah.
But
isn't there an auto parts?
It's on the opposite corner.
Yeah. Oh, on the okay. Oh, right.
That auto parts on the right.
There's two houses.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there are wetlands issues, and so I don't, you know, it's sort of a conundrum in that respect because you want to keep an edge there on the corner around Carlin Drive, but. There's probably not going to be a whole lot of development that would happen there because of the water issues. So that might be one that we'd have to look at a little bit more in more detail and think about.
Just right there.
Whether that makes sense to go to commercial or divided or something, because could potentially might have a sliver of commercial development right abutting Carlin Drive. Now that we have design standards for. Highway business zoning, which we didn't have until, you know, 5 years ago or whatever.
And frankly, we have so few opportunities for expanded commercial districts that we just look at those really carefully when we get them.
Yeah. And the green across the way from that is?
The green south and west.
On the other side of, it looks like, yes.
It's Barrett Street Marsh.
It's the outline of the.
Right.
It's just the outline, the way it printed.
Yeah, and the outline of the boundary.
Yeah. Got it.
And you could hold that URA just like you're doing that little sliver on Damon Road.
You
could argue just because of where it is and what's around it.
Right, that it might be not special as consideration.
Right, it's not as clear cut as all these others that are literally surrounded by.
Right.
By
right.
What's the orange unknown north of the Barrett Street? The big chunk of, right there.
Oh, unknown really means street name is unknown. Oh. And there's no street there. That is
the development?
The Hampshire Heights and the other.
Pathway Farms.
Pathway Farms, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, to me, I would like to hear an argument as to why we shouldn't turn all the URAs surrounded by yellow to URB because I don't see
the argument. So you're suggesting just to go straight to public hearing then?
Yeah. Exactly.
Right. Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'd just like to really familiarize myself with exactly what URB is versus URA. We've kind of glossed over that, but it does seem to make sense.
Okay. What information would you like us to provide that would help you?
Just a complete definition, that's all. Okay. We've got that. I think I might even have that. You might have.
Yeah, if you look at the table.
Manual you gave us, or it's online or something, isn't it? Yeah.
The URB table is, again, it's residential. It's primarily residential, except where we allow home offices. And. Single family, two family, three family, and then townhouse units. So the idea is not to have multifamily, large multifamily units, but more detached and.
So the townhouses can have up to three units.
Well, it's a quirk of our ordinance. Townhouses, you could have many townhouses, but the idea is that they're not one unit on top of the other, but they're side by side units. And for whatever reason, the community has decided that that's a better configuration, or that's more palatable. It's more, it speaks more like single-family residential living, and
so is there a limit how many you can put together or not?
There's not. Typically, the maximum is 8 in a block before you break and then have more units, but that actually isn't, I mean, we're going to talk about that later tonight, based on a recommendation from Agora about looking at small lot development, which sort of gets at that issue, is what is it about common land ownership but with units attached versus, you know, smaller lots of attached units. But
I mean, that seems like a significant change to go from single family to 8 townhomes that are all attached in a row.
Right, but again, it goes back to your lot. If you don't have a lot that can support that, then, and as you can see from the lot boundaries, there's not,
there's probably
there
not many of those
anyways.
Right. So right. It's really not even worth arguing about. Right.
Well, there's one discussion that came up when we were doing it before, and that is there will be pushback from people in neighborhoods who think that their neighborhood is going to change around them. And, you know, what I think we need to communicate is this is a long-range desired development plan that would allow for the town to be a healthy town 40 years from now, as it was, you know, in 1975 when this was set up. So I think we have to satisfy ourselves that there's a logical reason why we're proposing a change, and present that to City Council and at public hearing in a way that says, this is the goal we're after, this is the confusion that seems to be existing in the map, you know, purple surrounded by yellow. If you walked those neighborhoods, you wouldn't know one from another.
Right.
And I think the, you know, the idea that this has been a 40-year map and what we're after is that much again. And so it's not like the neighborhoods are going to change around them.
No, and that's...
A house or two will.
Right.
And that will, you know, that will be upsetting to the neighbor next door, but it would have been upsetting whether you were building a big single family or you were building a three-family designed as a three-family.
Right. But we had a lot of pushback saying URC when we changed the wording for that district, and everybody said, you're changing everything, everything's changing. And what we're really doing is changing the wording to reflect what actually existed, because nobody could build, none of those existing houses could exist with the way the zoning was currently written. And so this, you could argue, is the same thing, is that we did that, now step back and look at the map. We want the map to reflect what exists, and your little pocket of purple is surrounded by yellow. That doesn't make sense. And so we want density, less density, restricted. And that's the way, there's a logical flow in business up the main corridor, and that makes sense. And there's pockets of the map that don't make sense, and that's what we're trying to do.
So when Carolyn posed us what would be helpful in thinking about this, if you took the park area and you grade that out, so you took Charles Park and Look Park and anything else that fits that, maybe I don't think this goes out to the VA, but anything that doesn't really reflect the residential space, then my question is, do you have a way through census information to tell me what is the residential density within given units of space? In other words, could you say to me that between Elm Street and that whole yellow neighborhood right there, there are, you know, 470 people per, you know, 1,000 square feet. And in the purple area at the back on Ward Avenue, I've got less density, but close. And I'm not sure I'm really trying to answer your question. What would be helpful to allow us to look at purple versus yellow as it exists now and say, you know, because that's what you did before, was you actually tried to evaluate what is the difference, and if there's no difference, then there shouldn't be a zoning difference.
When you look at some of these places, it's hard to see how different it is. If you get back over there and go north of of the park into Prospect, you find some big pieces of property in that. Are those pieces of property where increased development really would occur if you, or is that again something that's already built up on like Jackson Street School or something and it isn't going to make any difference?
There's only some lots that are back there.
There are some that could be developed in there. So we just need to know that, to think about that and speak to that. I mean,
right,
I think that's...
But just, you know, the limits that, like off Jackson Street, there's a lot of wetlands in those areas.
Yeah.
And that we won't be able to map necessarily to tell you that.
Yeah.
But when we were arguing for the wording changes in the zones, to Devin's point, we showed like URC, average lot size is this, and this is what the zoning actually calls for, which the two aren't compatible. This is what actually exists, and it was easier for people to follow. Same thing if you did here. If you said URB, average lot size is this, and this little Ward Avenue pocket, look at the average lot size. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Or it's within shouting distance. Whereas it's labeled as URA, which wants to be this average size, the two, it's closer to B than it is to A.
Well, but that is what had me thinking about the elevation, because some of these larger lots are just not, they don't reflect the possibility of a buildable lot that size.
Right.
So.
I agree, but I think their proximity to downtown and what we want them to be, if the topography allows for it.
Oh, I just think they're going to skew the assessment.
Yeah, what you're trying to do.
Okay, okay.
But, you know, there's probably a way we could do because there's so few of those, we could probably do some.
Well, and I don't know, but I'm thinking that's part of the story on Round Hill. I don't know that, though. I can't quite get.
Not really.
Isn't that from Round Hill down to the
it's Hillside
Prospect, that drops pretty much right there.
Right, but it's all built out, except, and there. I mean, there are topographic changes, but there are houses all up that hill, up the street. So
well, and there are houses just like it on the backside of the hill.
Right.
So,
but I mean, I don't want to make it sound like we're saying there'd be no changes. There will be changes, maybe over 40 years. My guess is if we do what you're saying in terms of density, you're going to find the purple areas do have a slightly lower density than the yellow areas. It may not be dramatic. I'm just sort of looking at the map.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. I think that's probably true. Mm-hmm. It may not be enough, so much slower that it scares people, but, you know.
Yeah. I just
certainly
think,
if you count the park, it will.
Yeah. Right, right.
I mean, to me, it seems like if you showed this map, if you grabbed somebody off the street and said, I'm not even going to tell you what these colors mean, but this is what we want, you know, a business corridor, dense, less dense, restricted. This is what we're proposing. These purple turn to yellow and these purple turn to blue. Does that make sense to you? They'd say, yeah, that makes sense to me.
But I think it's true. I think what we would probably do is exclude the parks.
Yes.
And it's clearly not developable, so it doesn't throw that off.
To me, I'd say look park, child's park, or restricted.
When there's some odd little pieces
ago,
like that
City
lot
Council,
right there
blessing,
is not a lot.
To expand the Farms Forest Rivers to,
goes
to
down
cover
to
the new
path.
Construction
that's
area
like
nearby.
Yeah.
Probably this year we should be doing
access.
It, as you said, for Child's Park and
at the
park
well,
anyway.
And I believe
so it's not even the map. It's not even part of the paper.
Right. That would help the map.
It would help the map.
Oh, no, it's right there.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah, maybe, I mean, that almost should be a separate, did that first. You know, and got rid of chunks of purple and made it blue, that would just make the remaining purple look all the more awkward.
Less
right, as to
right.
why it's there.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, so if you want us to, we can go ahead and introduce that whenever you're ready. So it would be the new crop of open space we purchased, Child's Park. Look Park's a little more complicated only because we have to look at the text, because we want to make sure the things that Look Park has, you know, we're fine with wedding chapels, we're fine with community centers. And I'm not sure that's in the current FFR, but we could change it to be there.
Mm-hmm. And we also, you know, the other thing I noticed, there's some of this, I guess it only happened in that one section in the Woodlawn block, but the bike path runs through there, and it makes it look like there's a parcel that's developable, but it's really the rail trail.
Yeah.
But, yeah, we can mark out the schools and the... Parks.
Yeah, marking out the schools. Yeah, so that you're looking, so you see what it is that.
What's left.
Well, and at that point, I think it would be good to look at the lot size comparatively.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that's the point, is take out the anomalies and then look at the lot sizes and see if we really are dealing with different characteristics. And the other thing I think I'd like to think about is whether the design guidelines that we've got for A and B will lead to a different kind of development if it does happen. So if you take down a little bungalow and you can put up a three-family, does it matter whether you're in A or B? And I think that's something we ought to think about.
Mm-hmm. You mean, does it currently?
Have we allowed a very different looking design to be done?
Yeah, I mean, I think right as it stands now, the same design criteria hold across all three.
I think they do. I just think that we need to be able to say that. We need to think about it a minute and be able to say that, so that the concern that people would have that it's going to look very different is not really the truth. It's going to look about the same. It's what's inside that building and allowed by right.
Carolyn, what's the gray rectangular kind of northwest of Leeds Center or Florence Center?
Northwest, that's industrial, like office industrial. So the old, the casket company.
The casket.
Oh. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Along the trail.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Devin, to your point, I keep the image that keeps coming into my head, and it's really not that related to this discussion, but it is related to the design guidelines, is the thing that went up across from the Y, which is a horrible building and sort of ruined a whole bunch of people's views and
Adair place?
Yeah. Really?
Except that it's yellow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's for the people that live on that street.
Well, that modern house that went up probably caused problems too in the middle of, across from the park.
Those are dear friends of
you us. Know, it's right. Just a different style.
Yeah. Right. But I mean,
which one are you talking about, Dan?
It's
the tall place. One that went up with the angle.
Very angular.
Right.
Yeah.
So, how would you describe the big blue box that went up across from Nettleman's?
Yeah, that's
where?
Well, that's a.
Nuttleman's there at the former
job. Not the
yeah.
building.
I mean, that's not completely out of character with the architecture, but it's.
Nuttleman's right.
I think right. I so that not modern.
It is, but that's not.
You know, I think the design house, of that
you know,
building
you're talking than
about
was
is
there.
Is debatable. But what concerns me about that one is that it robbed the light of the house next door. And so that's something that I think when we're thinking about the size and scale of a neighborhood, that's what I'd want to be sensitive to. I mean, if somebody wants a
light
yellow
sky.
House or a blue house or a pink house, I'm fine with that.
Absolutely.
But to allow for the scale of a building to impinge upon what is the livability of the lot next door, I think is really something we should think about.
That's also, I mean, that's kind of the same argument Optical Studio made at Lumberyard, like,
right.
the, you know, which is not, I don't think, a sound argument for them to have made, because, like, I think the decision is if the zoning is designed to encourage infill development, we're going to have to, at some point, get to higher heights, you know, like, there's going to be some transition, you know.
It's a great argument to come back at me with. It really is.
It's just, yeah.
But then it becomes an argument.
I mean, that's business, right? I mean, I think that's...
Yeah.
Right.
It is, but...
The point
but,
is that the dimensional requirements in that zone allowed for a particular height, just
right.
like on Adair Place, that zone allows for a particular height. And so we've kind of, you know, sketched out this is the scale and scope of when it could be, and it's going to come up against existing development that doesn't have those same dimensional characteristics.
But, and the heights didn't change for B
right.
or A. They've always been 35 feet. So there's some houses that reach that height and others that don't in each neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. That one just, I think it, because of its unique design and because it's got to be pretty close to that 35-foot threshold, but when you're coming up from Adair Place, it looks like it's 65 feet, you know, because
right.
Adair dives down, so at the it just looms over the top of the street. But there's always been individual projects, individual houses that, you know, people are like, oh, can we do that? I remember, I don't know how many years ago that was on Elm Street when they put that brick porch enclosure.
That started the whole historic
that, everybody thing. Just went nuts over that. And letters to the editor were flying, can they do that? This is terrible, tear it down. And the historical district was, you know, on Elm Street was born. But in general, if you're going to promote, you know, that Adair place is close to downtown, it's walkable, you want infill, you want density. So you can't say that except for right here, you know. You can't.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I don't. It's more about, I think, the argument that you get from, as people look at what's happening,
yeah.
As you start shoehorning things in, and all of a sudden, you know, space is sometimes nice within a neighborhood. I understand the goal, but all of a sudden you take maybe a little bit too much space, and then you convert it into a lot too little space. Between houses.
I agree with that, but on that particular instance, that was a good-sized lot.
Oh, it was, absolutely. It's
a single-family home. It looks different than everything around it, and that's what's gotten people on.
And that lot wasn't even, that lot was created before the zoning change, so that was under the old lot size requirements. That's not even an infill.
On Adair or Massasoit?
Adair.
No, and as,
not the case.
As I said, it doesn't really, I know it's not related, but when this goes to hearing.
Right. It'll come up.
It will be mushed together.
I think what will happen for hearing is I think a lot more people will be attuned to the idea of what zoning changes mean, because there have been some infill development around town. So I think that, you know, this will not just happen without public discussion.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's good for us to sort of go through this as a board and think about the logic of what we're trying to do and why, and characterize it in a way that we feel genuine about presenting it to the council as a plan that is good for the city in the long run. I do think it's in my mind a very large demographic component to this, and there was a Pioneer Valley Planning Commission presentation not long ago by someone at UMass that does the local demographic analysis, and my takeaway from that presentation was we're about the same size we've been for years. We are getting just slightly older, so there's not younger. What does that mean for the housing stock? Is, you know, if it, I live in a yellow spot in town that if those houses were not allowed to have been split up over time, I don't know who could buy and take care of them and live there now. So I think that is what will, you know, the kind of thinking we've got to get our heads around.
But Wayne, is there no benefit though to having pockets of less density, like surrounded by density?
And there's this benefit of the homes being less dense. I mean, it doesn't really look that different. It's different. I mean, the reason parks like Childs Park are so important mm-hmm. is that's really where we're getting the open space. So we need to be creating mm-hmm. more parks. But I'm not really sure that the fact that somebody has a big backyard and a single family facing two family mm-hmm. really makes the street feel very different. Yeah.
So Carolyn, do you need anything from us tonight, or is this the first step just to review, or are we in agreement that the first step should be Childs Park and look into Look Park to see if we can get our baseline kind of clean it up a little bit to get those over to restricted?
Well, I mean, I think I hear that you all think this is valid to move forward with proposed changes, but with more clear identification of the parks and the schools and some more data, which we can do before we would bring it, you know, or pitch it to council. So I think we can take all the comments that you've made and move it forward that way, or if you want to take one last look at it before it actually gets introduced, we can do that too.
I'd like to get one more look at it, because I think what I'm asking, or what I've heard that we're asking, is take out the anomalies, give us some data that says purple is not that different than yellow. and then I feel like we've got good good basis for taking it forward.
I agree with that, but while there you're getting the data for that, should we move forward on the recently purchased property and the two parks to clean up this map?
Oh, I see, to go ahead and rezone those.
Yes.
I don't think you can, you didn't mention it, but you did, Carolyn. I don't think you can include the schools, I wouldn't imagine, with the park.
So
no, I just, yeah.
In terms of the FFR, we can't, but in terms of the map we present to council, we can shade the matter something so it doesn't grab your eye.
Right. Right. Yeah, I didn't think we were going to change.
And label.
No.
Change. Right.
And the same thing with Brook Park. You can, put a diagonal set of green and white colors on it or something just so people recognize that it's Look Park without ever having to go to.
Right, unless you're ready for us to go forward.
Right. Yeah, we could do
that. But I mean, if you had trouble.
Why wouldn't we?
Right.
You know what I mean? I know rather than.
That kind of preserves and protects it, I guess, right. In another way. Not that there isn't already.
But. Yeah, anyway, it makes perfect sense. Again, just, you know, we have to make some text changes to FFR to make sure that.
Right.
I think what we're going to say is park structures of any kind are allowed. Mm-hmm. You know, they could serve a park. But, so if you guys, if that's okay with you, we'll take this as we should go forward and introduce FFR to City Council now. And then next time there's time to discuss these, we can come back with the data you're asking.
I would recommend to do that, and then and then compare and contrast purple to yellow with some data so that we can be better informed when we look at this again. And then so when we move forward, we have some numbers to support the argument.
Yeah. I'm thinking that taking care of the parks now gives us a reason to say, and then we almost had to look at what was left. How could you? It's such a gerrymandering, you know, sort of process. We took out this piece, and then it just begged for a question of why.
I think as obvious as it is now, it'll become even more obvious once we take that out of the equation.
Yeah. Okay.
We want to. We probably should have a formal vote for the FFR, so we can say it's sponsored by you.
So you need a motion?
I do.
So the parks, both parks, would be FFR.
Both parks would be FFR, and whatever other conservation land we've purchased
recently purchased.
And then again, and the text, the minor text change to FFR. So.
Well, before you do that, there are a couple of other odd little pieces, and I want to know if we're doing it with those too, like. We had a sidebar conversation on the corner of Washington and James. There's the way down into the park on the river, the path on the river. I don't know who owns that, but are there other pieces in the blues that are obviously not residences?
So it brings up an interesting issue, which is the area near Ward Avenue in particular. It's all privately owned land. The public's been using it for at least 60 years, and it's clearly a right to go there.
Okay.
So far, for FFR, we've only done publicly owned land. Child's Park's private, but it's sort of quasi-public. Mm-hmm. So we certainly could do the river. It's still in the plans to do it at some point, hence the name Rivers in FFR.
Mm-hmm.
But we haven't yet done private property, so the question is, do we want to do
it? Okay, well, but it's SC anyway, the back.
Right.
It's just that strip. Deb, in that particular piece, there is a house on that. It's just the other side of it has the easement for DPW.
Okay.
So it's essentially built out.
And I didn't really mean to pick on that particular piece, but we mentioned something along the bike trail. And, and I'm just, I'm saying, are we being too restrictive to identify two parks?
It might make sense to do the bike paths, actually.
In FFR?
Yeah, they're permanently protected. You know, if that's the line of what's permanently protected.
Yeah.
Okay, what I'm wanting to do is I want a motion that is broad enough to give you the latitude to identify the places that shouldn't be blue.
Right.
You know, they just.
And so maybe have a permanently protected land within that. Mm-hmm.
Right.
You can do that assessment.
Okay. Does anybody
parks and permanently protected land?
Yeah.
Okay. So, John, second.
Mark made the motion as amended, and John seconded. All in favor? Is that a no scratch or a vote?
That was this.
I'm sorry. Okay.
follow up on recommendations from the housing build-out analysis? I assume, I mean, we have done, you are to your satisfaction?
Yep. So, I think all of you were here, except for Bill, at the last meeting, but we had the consultants who conducted this build-out analysis, particularly in the C district, actually, but looked at the zoning, I think a bit B, too, because, well, no, the, I guess the Smith College land is C. But at any rate, made a few recommendations, several recommendations, and so a couple of the key things that were are itemized as A and B here were we felt like we should pitch, sort of coming off the heels of that conversation, it's sort of this outside look at how we do things, how we regulate development, and what would really enable and facilitate some of this, some infill. So the one of the recommendations they made was, and they discussed the potential conflicts or misunderstanding about what's allowed by right versus at what point do you need site plan, and that it's just, it becomes a little bit of a barrier for someone to move forward with a project if they feel like there's a an onerous process to undertake just to build a 3 or 4 family structure in the urban residential C. So even though we allow, for example, a 3-family structure in urban residential C, there's another part of the zoning that says anything over 2,000 square feet triggers site plan, no matter what project. Even if the use is allowed by right, you still need to come to the planning board. So this first item, they recommended that we evaluate those thresholds that would trigger a planning board site plan review, and maybe there'd be a different sort of a lesser review potentially at a staff level for some of these site plans that are really minor. And right now we have, or I don't mean minor in their impact necessarily, but just their smaller projects. And the way we've labeled them in the zoning for at least 20 years is that anything that's new construction of 2,000 square feet up to 5,000 square feet is considered an intermediate project, goes to the planning board. Anything that's 5,000 square feet and bigger or requires 9 or more parking spaces, and there are a couple of the thresholds, goes to the planning board as well, but we call it a major project, and you have to do a traffic study and stormwater management on top of all the other elements that you need to show in your site plan, lighting, access, landscaping, building elevations. So we took the opportunity internally to think about ways that we could create, instead of calling it an intermediate site plan for the smaller projects, maybe do an administrative site plan review at the staff level that would be appealable to the planning board. And also we would notify abutters of the internal review and then notify the abutters of the decision, but have it in the office and have staff review and sign off, and the director of planning do the sign off.
You lost me. For up to, for what size? That what we're now calling intermediate?
Right, which size. Is 2,000 right. to 5,000, right. Although in the draft that's we sent you this afternoon that's in front of you, we just threw out as a number, bumping it up to 6,000 square feet instead of 5,000. There's not really any magic necessarily about 5,000, except that the consultants suggested that, you know, you could probably pretty easily get to 5,000 with a 3 or 4 family structure in urban residential C. So maybe 5,000 is a little bit low for calling it a major project. You know, sort of big picture, what's in front of you is a draft change that would suggest, or that would propose, creating a two-tiered site plan review using that concept of sort of minor and major project, but having the minor projects be an administrative site plan review, and then the major project still coming to planning board. And anything else that's special permit and site plan obviously come to the planning board.
It could be appealed by either the applicant or the abutters. Interestingly, this is sort of the approach we took to central business. We expected, when central business architecture was created, that you get a lot of appeals. And the one you had this year on Pleasant Street was the first we've ever had, right? So we had that in the books for, I don't know, a dozen years, and we had the first year. So I'm sure there are going to be appeals, but I doubt it's going to be that many appeals for the process. But it's hard to judge.
This setup is right now for under 2,000 square feet.
We can.
It's internal right now, staff. Right. What's that?
Right now it's by right.
Right, under we don't two. Really look oh, the, at
right,
this.
Right, right. But over 2,000 is the trigger. It comes to us without staff, the opportunity for staff to solely review.
Right.
So 2 to 5 staff looks at it. If it's appealed.
2 to 6 staff looks at it.
2 to 6. If it's appealed, it comes to us. If it's special permit, it comes to us. If it's over 6, it comes to us.
And this is pretty much for residential structures.
It would be commercial. We don't get that many commercial in that category. But if a commercial structure was in that category, it would also be the same thing.
So we're not just talking about changes to the residential districts. It would be across the board in all the districts. Anything that's less than 6,000 square feet, what's proposed in here would be staff level review.
But the commercial is actually usually less controversial, because the commercial is, I mean, usually the big issues that you guys are dealing with small projects is about parking lot layout and bike and pet accommodations. They're not really discretionary things for those projects.
But to be clear, this would allow a 3-family in URB at 2,000 square feet per family, so a 6,000 square foot building. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty big building. So I want to like characterize it for you that way.
Right. But again, the use, whether it's staff or the board, the use is allowed by right, so you're only looking at the site issues anyway. So we're not changing special permit thresholds, which are the places where you could say no. So it's only the issues of how does the lot work.
And you've defined a lot about how the lot should work in the zoning, particularly in the new design standard. So you've talked about the zoning talks about where the parking, how the parking needs to be oriented, where the landscaping needs to go, and there's very specific standards about lighting and egresses and things of that sort. So
to both of you, let me restate what I think I just heard, which is that the plans that are coming to you in this category of 2 to 6 are by right, and that what we would be trying to do with those is just work around our usual perimeter to fix the little things that we have that we can do, and that we would then be saying to you that makes sense for you to do that for those categories.
That's right. So the more complicated projects would still come to you, and the special permit, no matter how small. Someone's doing a funeral home that's 2,000 feet, it would still come to you.
Okay. Do you think the public takes any satisfaction that we go through that onerous process for site plan? In other words, I know you've heard from the analysis side and those and the development side that says, you know, we'd be more interested in developing here if the path were certain. Mm-hmm. But because you've got this uncertain path that we're taking, that makes it harder for us to commit our resources here as opposed to 100 miles away or the next community over.
Yeah. I mean, it seems to me it's much more business friendly with what you're proposing. I mean, it doesn't seem like we change a whole lot, and really we don't have a heck of a lot of say in the matter as long as it's in compliance, which you seem to check, you know, pretty thoroughly when it's presented to us. So that seems to make sense to me.
Yeah, going back to Devin's question, I think the answer is when people are getting satisfaction, they don't care who gets it. When they're not getting satisfaction, they don't care who gets it. And so I think you're going to see some of it. And what's hard is the things that are controversial aren't always by size. So I'm glad if you were on the board at the time, but when Florence Savings wanted to build closer property boundary on Finn Street, and it was about fencing and landscaping, it was something that, frankly, I would have guessed was a minor thing. And it was one of the most controversial things that I've seen. Mm-hmm. And just, it's hard to judge those things. But the smaller the project, generally, at least if nothing else, generally fewer people care. Right. Maybe someone still feels passionately. But.
One last thing. When you do your staff analysis report to us, is that's not a public document. That's a document.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So for A&Rs, do you do staff notes in any shape or form? Would there be any advantage to documenting your thinking?
What we would probably do for separation is Carolyn would do the review the way she does for you, and I would be the one making the decision unless it's near where I live or something, I have to remove it. Uh-huh. So there'd be some separation in terms of the analysis this person.
And I'm not trying to make work for your office. I'm just thinking about the record that exists for the decisions that are made. Is there any, is, you know, and you're probably thinking, oh, no workload, but.
Well, no, I think, and what's in here is a process that mirrors the planning board permitting process. So the applicant would still get a decision. They'd still have to record it. It's just, it expedites the review, and it's, you know, one person coming in and, you know, and then sort of going back to your question again, well, what about, how would the public feel about, you know, the board not reviewing, is, did they feel like that's one less mechanism for them to respond? But to the extent that we're going to be notifying, what's proposed is notification of the abutters in the same way, but a shorter notification process. So a week ahead of the scheduled meeting, those people who feel like they have to come, they can come and listen to, you know, Wayne, or review and grant a decision one way or the other. And so then it's sort of an administrative hearing in that regard, because the neighbors could say, hey, what about this? And if it hasn't been, you know, considered, then that can be wrapped into a decision, which then would get recorded. But it just shortens the timelines, and it's really an expedition.
The appeals process is how quick then? You tell them no, they don't like your decision, they get on the docket pretty fast, or what?
Well, it says there's an appeals period. The way we pitched is to follow sort of what other administrative appeals are, which are 30 days. So you have 30 days to appeal. So that's still a long time.
I actually want to shorten that if we're trying to make this easier.
Yeah.
Right, but you can appeal immediately and
and
get on the docket.
And then appeal to then
right.
the board.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Would the documentation, for lack of a better phrase, of the result be brought forward to the planning board as an A&R, like tonight? We're going to see a couple where you could say,
well, the intent
this 4,000 square foot project came in, was approved, staff level approved it, we're good, no appeals, here it is, or would we never even know it existed?
Well, that could be up to you. I mean, we could certainly report out, you know, this month we did X, Y, and Z site plans. I wouldn't want it to be, the mechanism for A&R now actually requires the board to vote to sign off on it. So I wouldn't want that to be part, because that sort of detracts from the goal of trying to create an expedited process. But we certainly could, you know, keep them.
I think it's helpful to know what's going on.
I would almost advocate taking baby steps, where the thresholds that exist right now are 2 to 5. And I would say take those parameters, and what was an immediate trigger for planning board review is now going to be done internally with staff. And then as we move forward and you review those projects, you bring those forward and we say, hey, this month we had 2, or it's been 9 months, we haven't had any.
Yep.
Or, oh my God, we're getting, you know, 10 a month.
Yeah.
And then because the 6,000 seems somewhat arbitrary, and to go from 2, which we've been used to seeing forever, to 6, you know, and triple that, it seems like there might be pushback, versus where we have existing parameters now, and what was, we're just taking who's reviewing those parameters. We're not changing the parameters, we're just changing who's looking at those. But then we still get input as to what's happening behind closed doors. just so we can respond to it. You know,
I'm not following the 5,000 exist as a marker now.
Well, over five, we,
right.
Minor and major.
Okay.
So 2 to 5 is minor, over 5 is major. And now we're saying, let's go staff level, but tweak that 5 to 6. And that's the only part that's, yeah, I'm saying keep it at 2 to 5 at staff level and let us know how it's going. And then if we want to, in time, move that back up, that's fine.
Any other opinions on 5 or 6?
Well, just a question about why did the consultants come up with this feeling that there was a barrier to people?
So it takes longer to, you know, to get on your schedule, sort of adds, it's 2 or 3 weeks longer to go through the process. And it's harder to predict. And those are the two things that a developer really gets scared about.
But
do you have a sense?
That's pushing people away?
Yeah. Do you have a sense that you've lost things on that basis?
You know, it's interesting. I don't know the answer. I mean, it's sort of, that's why we wanted an outside person to say. So he was sort of, one of the things he distinguished in his talking is local developers who may get to know the board and have their own predictions of what you guys are going to do, and then somebody who doesn't know it who's just looking it up. And his expertise was more on the outsiders. You know, if he had a client in town that he didn't know, he didn't know how the board ruled, he read the regs, he would be nervous about the site plan process.
Right.
But what are
I think it's kind of an intimidating process, to tell you the truth, to stand up here and, you know, appear in front of Mr. Grinnell and Ms. Bruce over there, and I don't think it has to be. I mean, I feel that you know, we've got experts that are in the city that, you know, they have the regulations to go by, and it makes a lot of sense. So,
well, especially at you know, 2,100 square feet. You know what I mean?
Right.
That's there's not a lot happening there, and to go through this effort for something like that, I could see.
I was just curious whether it was having an impact, that's all.
I mean, occasionally we do see, you know, we see it more on the margins of either end. So if someone's planning a project that could be 2,000, could be 2,100 square feet, they drop it to 1,999.
Mm-hmm.
And then same thing for a major project.
Mm-hmm.
If they're getting close to 5,000, they'll drop it just below so they don't have to do the major.
Right.
And the other test, just think about tests of surrogates. Yes, we don't really know, but we know the surrogates.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the surrogates is, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, you and City Council changed the threshold so that for pre-existing non-conforming uses, which used to always require a permit from the zoning board, if you polled all your neighbors within 300 feet and they signed off, you didn't have to go before the board. And it's a lot of work to call all your neighbors with 300 feet. And the number's not huge, but a significant number of people want to do that. They'd rather knock on a lot of people's doors than go before a board, which again
right.
is an indication that people want to avoid that.
Right.
Well, and the other thing about you don't know what you lose is because you will
right.
have developers making decisions and you'll never know that they viewed one community's process in advantage of
right.
another. Any more discussion about whether this is a good idea? Could I get a motion on allowing planning board to take over the process for A&Rs for 2,000 to 5,000 or 6,000? Have we settled on 5? Could I just get a nod?
Well, do you want to, can I ask you, do you want us to change this language and do you want to look at it again before we put it forward to the public hearing process, or are you good to go with those changes?
Because it's the whole, it's all of the changes that you put in this document that we're looking at. I think we should, I mean,
yeah,
we just
I
got
didn't
this.
Get a chance
right.
to look at
yeah.
it.
I also want to highlight something so you don't think we're sneaking this through. So the other thing that's in this package, is this one word we're taking out, but it's a significant word. Right now you have to get a site plan approval either concurrent with or prior to the special permit. That's hard for some projects. For some projects, you want to know, can you do this project?
Mm-hmm.
And then you want to work out the details.
Mm-hmm.
We raised the board 5 years ago, so I can't remember who was on and who wasn't, and the board didn't want to do that then. Because it's nice to see everything. The problem, you know, this comes up, the classic example is the state hospital. I don't think the state hospital could have ever happened if they had to do the entire site plan first.
Mm-hmm.
And so it doesn't come up that often. Most people want to do it once. They only want to go before the board one night, not to go two different nights.
Mm-hmm.
But if I have a big project, I want to know, what's the number of units I can do in this project? We had one on Fruit Street that ended up being turned down.
Mm-hmm.
But in URC, we allowed mixed use. Someone went to a doctor's office on Fruit Street, came before the board, and the board said, no, you can't do that. But at least he was really happy he could just do the special permit, because he said, okay, can't do it, I'm gonna go somewhere else. And not have to go through all the development. And but so that's in here as well, as long as we're messing with it, I wanna make sure you, that's either okay or not okay with you.
Okay, well,
I'm sorry, so that guy in Fruit Street did that and was happy that we had that in place already?
Well, he wasn't happy he got turned down. But
no, I know that.
He saved $10,000.
So what are we changing?
Somewhere in the process, either he didn't follow the rules or the process changed, I don't know. He only applied for a special permit. We now say pretty clearly, you have to apply for site plan.
Oh, we now say that.
Well, I think, wasn't it that it did say that? It said that for a while, but there were projects that were allowed to go forward outside of that, contrary to that. So there had been, like the State Hospital came through, and the language in the text still said, you can't get a building permit until you've done site plan and special permit, you know, special permit, and this language that's stricken now in this proposed text. But for one of the projects, we staff had recommended that the applicant go just for the special permit with a conceptual site plan, and we were that requirement was highlighted to us to say, no, they can't do that. They have to get their site plan at the same time. You can't possibly approve the special permit without that. So that's the time at which internally we realized there was an issue in the text that it really did say you can't get your special permit until you have your site
plan. But it's pretty hard to understand that text, I'll tell you that.
I think the argument we had 5 years ago was that if they come for a special permit only and it's approved, it's almost impossible when all you're left with is site plan approval to reject that.
Yes.
Because it's black, site plan is just black and white.
Absolutely.
So as long as they're within, you know, the setbacks and so forth, we can't do anything about it. And so if we, and the issues we had at Hospital Hill was that we were getting little pieces of the puzzle and we couldn't get the big picture, and we thought we lost out on some opportunity because of that, and we may have done some things differently. And I know that was the concern, was that while we understand if you're a developer and you're saying, just can I do this or not, because there's a cost to develop a site plan, a review, an engineered set of drawings, and I'm going to pay somebody to develop this, if you're just going to tell me, well, that's a bad fit for the city, then I've just wasted a lot of time. So how do you reconcile those two?
So I think
we get a smaller scale approach maybe, where we have this two-stage approach for smaller projects or up to a certain size maybe there.
Well, I don't think it's the size. I think it's sort of the discipline that you follow. I think it's you have to be comfortable when you issue the special permit that yes, this project goes forward, that later on you just get to look at parking and landscaping and those issues. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Fruit Street's a good example of you or your predecessors just thought a doctor's office didn't make sense on Fruit Street, so you're able to give that feedback. State Hospital, you know, hindsight's 20/20, but we should have been, when the special permit came through, there's some things we should have said, it's okay to just do the special permit, but you need to spell out in more detail what you're doing. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's how do we deal with those things.
I'm just thinking of like a recent example when the Cumberland Farms came in front of us at Florence Center. Was that a special permit, or is that?
Yeah,
that was special.
That was a whole
permit.
Lot of stuff.
So that was site plan and special permit at the same time.
Uh-huh. So that's a good example. There's two ways you could have looked at it. You could say, sorry, there's not information, special permit, you have to come back. Or you could say, special permit for the building has to be crowded up to the street. And when you come back for site plan, that's what we're going to be looking at, is making sure the building has to be, the parking lot can't face Main Street, only the building.
Well, but it's a good example in that sense, but it's not in another, in that entity coming before us had stock building plans, so they weren't worried about whether they had to invest in the design and engineering drawings and all of that. So I see a value in saying to someone, yes, we like what we think you're telling us, and it makes sense for you to go spend more money to tell us exactly what you want to do. So that two-stage makes sense to me, because
right.
It just business-wise it does. Mm-hmm. But I agree, I came on the board after the
Hospital Hill plan was in effect, and it seemed, we seemed to stumble over it for years after that. So I'd like a process that allows us to be, and maybe we are now, maybe we're gun shy and we'll be better at, you know, at tying those things down.
I think I know that was, that's what it came down to with the board, was just this level of unease, because site plan, we really can't, we don't have a lot of authority. Special permits where we can sink our teeth into it. And if site plan goes before that, it's a more informed discussion when we get the special permit. If somebody comes in with a special permit request and it's kind of this ambiguous, you know, can we put a Cumbie's in the middle of Florence and we don't have the particulars, where is it, how tall is it, what's going on? I know people would, there was a concern that there would be situations where maybe we end up approving a special permit with not a lot of information, and once that's approved, that's it. Because there's no way to go back as long as they meet the setbacks and so forth, and come forward with a site plan that everybody sees for the first time. We're like, well, this isn't what I thought it was going to look like, but then it's too late.
So to summarize, I'm hearing, and I think we can all agree that we'd love for you to make the changes that we discussed, and that since this is something that we can, you know, look at 2 weeks from now or 4 weeks from now, we'd like to see it again. Mm-hmm. And I need some time to read it myself. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is there an interim step where instead of a full site plan, if your project requires a special permit, and concurrently or prior to, you need a site plan, but if the trigger is special permit, that we can get some sort of outline that isn't a fully developed engineered set of drawings that costs $10,000 to get, but it's enough for us to, you know, get at?
I assume that's happening in conversation and meetings between whoever's thinking about doing that and the planning office anyway, wouldn't?
Well, I think that's the way we've written it, is that you get enough of a conceptual site plan to understand how the site's going to function.
And if we don't have it, we send it back.
With that given use. Yeah, and if you don't.
Reject the special permit.
Right. Or reject it, or put conditions on that when the site plan comes back, it has to have X, Y, and Z on it.
Isn't that what just happened at one of the last Village Hill developments? We saw a conceptual plan first.
Yeah, so that's so. Yeah. And for subdivision approval, we have that process, but it's under the, you know, different requirements under subdivision that say first you have to provide a conceptual to get the yay or nay, move forward to the full cost engineered plan for definitive subdivision.
So Carol, I think something's in there about what are the things you have to file as part of it for if you're doing a site special permit only, but we can work also on language on just being really clear that. Planning board reserves the right to turn down a special permit or to require the site plan come in with a special permit if it's not clear what the project is. So you have to, so maybe, because there may be some project where it makes perfectly sense to separate,
right,
and some project where it doesn't, and we can leave that to you all to decide. So if an applicant files just special permit, they know there's a chance they have to wait for the site plan.
Are the subdivision regs that Tess just brought up, are those different than, I mean, what if those apply to this case where we're trying to have special permit only, or
we can mirror that language, but we'd have to write it in the zoning. Mm-hmm. And the other piece of it is the applicant could, I mean, I think the wiggle room in the language is a good way to address it, that the board could also do a 6-month continuance and say, okay, here's 6 months to do your site plan. We really can't vote on it right now, but we can leave it open if you want. And that's another way. I mean, that's obviously a risk for the applicant, but then maybe that's a better risk if they feel like they can get a, you know, yay or nay on the use without having to do the engineer plans.
So don't spend too much time then reading what Carolyn sent you. We'll work tomorrow and sort of send you a revised draft. So. It's going to be a bit general outline. We're trying to address these things. And some choices.
I mean, I get as a developer, you don't want to see, like, oh, the way it's written, I have to put a lot of effort into it, a project that I'm not even sure if I can even do. And so that's understandable. But at the same time, I'd like to have as big a hammer as possible.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
moving right along. Thanks, we'll look for that. Small lot brainstorm.
So this was another, I mean, I think they focused a lot of their presentation on the concept of allowing smaller lots, even smaller than the 50-foot frontage lots that we, that the zoning has just changed to allow. And the idea, their thinking, if you recall, is that people don't like to be in condominium associations, and then it's just easier and cleaner to have your own property in your own building, and that if you have easements, that's easier to deal with than a whole condominium association on for a big parcel with lots of units. So this is really to sort of start that conversation or to start thinking about it. You know, there is an example in Northampton. I should have pulled that up. It's probably on this map here. There's some townhouses off of Hatfield Street that are all carved up into these skinny lots, and they don't have frontage. So it's not exactly the concept that I think the consultant was talking about, because we'd still want frontage, but they're basically all the units are on their own individual lots.
Is this across from the cemetery?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
You know, in that. Yeah. And if you look on the map, you can see these tiny little slivers. But it's the only example, I think, right, in the city of that.
Laura Park tried to do it. Laura Park filed an A&R years ago with us, showing everyone who owned the land underneath their building. But it wasn't actually legal. I think they filed the registry illegally. But
are these ones on Hatfield Street? Are they attached?
This is Warburg.
Each other?
What's that? Yeah. I think
yeah.
that's
they're attached, yeah.
Yeah.
But is there, so in the presentation they were talking about like five or six townhouses attached to each other, but physically there was a firewall in between them, so they're really...
I don't think that's the part we care about. I mean, from our standpoint, it's zero lot line building. Whether you have the buildings that are integrated together, which has some cost savings for construction, or separate, it's really a private sector that we wouldn't be regulating. It just, it would look and feel like a condominium project, but it would
right.
be simple ownership. I mean, he focused a lot on market demand and people not liking condos. But the bigger thing, actually, since the recession, is condos, not so much in Northampton, but condos in a lot of the country crash more than single-family homes in a lot of the country. And banks have been really straight. If you need a mortgage and you want to buy a unit in River Run Apartments, as an individual, it's hard for you to get a mortgage because the bank's going to say a majority of this place is rented, and we don't like being in the rental business. And so often what happens to the entire project makes it hard for individual projects. So, mm-hmm. you know, so I think that's the bigger reason for doing it. But the idea is to make it look and feel just like any other townhouse project.
I know when they made that presentation, they were focused on URC, right? So all these recommendations would be things that could be developed in URC.
Some of the things like that would translate. They're charged them with URC.
Okay, but that would be, if we were to allow zero lot line development like that, that could also be in central business, right? Okay.
Well, yeah. We don't have a frontage requirement in central business, so it's kind of, we already
have it, basically.
Have it, right. Essentially. There's no lot, there's no minimum lot size, and there's no frontage.
So if I wanted to, like, raise the Brake King and do a bunch of row houses,
yes,
I could do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Want to do it?
Yeah.
Except you can't have for commercial residential on the first floor along
right.
the
second. Yeah.
But otherwise, yes.
In the back.
I really want a grocery
that's
store
right.
at that That's my big one. Okay, so I just want to confirm.
So yeah. that's kind of like the units behind the Wood Star don't have frontage.
Right.
They're
right.
just their own parcel in the back.
Right.
So part of the approach would be, you know, this isn't trying to be a backdoor approach to yet again increase the frontage in URC. So it's trying to say, however many lots you could do as a condo, let's give you the option for that being fee simple. It's not a way to create more lots than you do otherwise.
It's great. Condos are tough.
Especially small condos.
Especially right. small condos, yeah. I mean, it's a great option, I think, for us. And you know, we often talk about, the one thing that they didn't talk about in their report, you know, they were talking about family housing, but didn't really talk about family housing in town, you know, that conceptually something like a smaller unit like a row house or a condo for, you know, for families. So I think it'd be great. whatever we have to do it, let's do it.
So for A, you're going to write up something that comes to us. For B, incorporating that idea, you would end up doing the same.
Yeah.
So is there anything else you want to ask us about? I mean, brainstorming implies that you're collecting information from us so you could see what you want to do and bring it back to us. Is there anything else that you've thought about small lots that...
No, which I guess why we did the brainstorm. You know, are there other things that are important to you to make it work? I mean, first, are you want, does this make sense to go forward? And if so, are there things that you might say, if this, I like it, and if this, I wouldn't like it?
Mm-hmm. As a tangential conversation with what's happening in Hadley with the tiny house.
That's just exactly where I was going to.
Where are we from a zoning standpoint?
So one of the changes, at least in Europe and New York City, is we now allow multiple structures in the same lot. So you know, part of the issue in Hadley is you're only allowed to have one structure in a lot. So we do allow multiple structures, but we don't allow trailers. And part of the thing, frankly, that makes me worried about this whole Hadley piece is, so when Mount Holyoke well-educated students do it, it's okay, and when someone brings in a mobile home, it's not okay.
Right.
So we would allow a tiny house, but it would have to be on a permanent foundation.
And they frequently are.
And not powered by extension cords.
Right.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, this person came and looked for places in Northampton, but the answer is, you know, we want to create permanent neighborhoods. We don't want, you know, transient neighborhoods.
Did she put it on wheels because she wasn't sure she could keep it wherever it was?
I mean, no, it was built that way.
The option.
And she, I think she doesn't want it to be permanent. I mean,
I'm not sure that's just her. There's a whole category of those mobile. Small houses that are...
And they're not necessarily on wheels, is what I was trying to say.
Yes, but there are lots of them that are, is what I'm trying to say. They really are, you know, out in the West Coast, it's a trend almost.
Yeah. They're beautiful.
So we don't allow them in that way, and I don't think we could unless we were buying mobile homes. I don't think we couldn't distinguish between
them.
No. Is there any parking consideration for small lots that needs to be...
Well, we have we changed the parking requirements, so you need one parking space per 1,000 square feet, and we took away the fraction. So, you know, you probably need one parking space for that, for a unit like that. But, you know, someone could always come to the planning board for, well, I don't know if you could waive the entire parking requirement, but, you know, I think it depends on where these are located. I mean, that's not really accessible by transit. The places she was looking in Northampton weren't accessible by transit either. So
all I'm saying is the parking requirements that we have now make sense for this small lot discussion. And so do we have any advice to give the planning office on that? If it's within URC, do we, you know, or it's not commercial, so commercial has no parking. But you are
some commercials, right? Yeah.
So we did do an assessment. The registry records are public. So our GIS guy did an assessment of how many vehicles per dwelling unit do we have in different districts in around the city.
Oh.
And not surprisingly, and I've got the exact numbers, downtown, between the densest districts, the highest car ownership and the lowest car ownership was about 3-1. So a lot less car owners per unit downtown. But when we normalized based on population, because we have fewer people per units, it was a lot less. There was still more car ownership, but it was down to sort of 2-1.
Okay.
You know, if the average unit downtown is 1.5 people and the outlying areas is 4 people, mm-hmm. obviously there are going to be more cars in the outlying areas. When we corrected for that, there were still more cars out there, but it wasn't mm-hmm. as dramatic.
Okay.
But part of that is, yes, it means downtown there's fewer cars, but we're not yet at a point like New York or Boston where a lot of people have no cars.
So how would that work? Would it be a developer that would come before your office and say, this is the project I want to do, and it's small houses, and then would the lot actually get divided up? I mean, is that what you're saying? And then those would become the small lots. And so do you have an idea that you would want, like, a minimum for those small lots?
Minimum lot size?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think the idea is that you couldn't do more units than you would on the
undivided parcel. So if you had 50 feet of frontage and 10,000 square feet, that allows you to do four units. So then you could divide it into four separate lots.
Mm-hmm. That have no frontage requirements.
Well, but there are other design standards, so you want the units to face the street. So potentially they'd be all facing the street. So there might be, mm-hmm. you know, 15 feet of frontage or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Right, so those are the kind of things we have to look at. I mean, I think ideally they'd face the street, or they would look like they faced a street, you know, a friendly roadway or a friendly walkway, mm-hmm. but so they're facing something, whatever that something is.
But their deed would say they have 15 feet of frontage.
Well, or maybe it's not frontage on the street. It might have 15 feet of frontage on a driveway, potentially. Mm-hmm. But we wouldn't want that. There's a difference between a driveway that looks and feels like a street and a parking lot that you're on top of.
So. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Or it might look like a detached accessory structure. So if you're really doing a tiny house on a tiny lot, you might have a rear lot that's mm-hmm. a smaller structure behind something that's on the street. And then that might not have any frontage at all, but might just have a, you know, a pedestrian path or something.
I mean, these aren't tiny houses, but look behind the old fire station. Right. Those two houses back there, both of which are quite large, mm-hmm. but they own 10 feet more than the footprint of their house. They're separate lots.
So use that example, and if you had a lot that allowed for four townhouses, four units, and instead of having them attached, they were detached. So now you have four individual little townhouses, and one burns down or goes derelict or whatever. And it's the third out of four, and somebody moves in, would they be able to make something like behind the old fire station where now they've got this giant structure sandwiched in between three little structures, and now we're just getting out of whack, you know what I mean? And could that happen, or?
It could potentially. I mean, so I guess the question is, do we want to have a separate set of design standards for this? Is this just allowing the units, or do we want to play with design? Because you could think about that from a design standard standpoint.
I mean, I think what you can do four, excuse me, if you could do four, whether it's on one lot or four little lots, that's fine, if it always stays that way.
Right.
But if it's not always that way, are we opening our eventually ourselves up to something that we don't want?
Right, right.
Yeah, I think this does sort of smell like a sort of subdivision kind of thing, like the rules that apply should apply to that sort of category. That's not, I'm not talking about streets and subdivision really, but I'm with you. It's not the same to take a lot that's a single family lot that could have multiple people in a building and then divide that lot all up. I think the cascading effects is exactly what we need to think about.
Well, the other piece of it, too, I would imagine, and, you know, maybe not in every situation, but let's just say four units, that is going to trigger site plan. So there could be some site plan standards for the situation where you're creating small lots under that provision that talks about uniformity of massing or yeah. something mm-hmm. like that. So that when it comes in, then each of those individual lots, even when they're sold off, they're still bound by that approval.
Right.
And I think did the consultants give you other communities that
no, this? No, over 2,000 square feet, which triggers site plan.
Yeah, they had some pictures. They had some, yeah. a couple of images, right, in their report of examples of it. But
I thought he may have emailed us someone's ordinance, too, but I have to look that up.
Okay. I mean, from a development perspective, I think it's great. I mean, it's, you know, having gone to 11 banks to get our first condo mortgage and have them turn us down, and yeah. to have an incredibly fraught condominium association process. I mean, to have fee simple ownership from, you know, separate and apart from streamlining the site plan process, like this is a great change to kind of encourage, you know, in-town ownership. I mean, it's really a very different, I'd much rather own like this mm. than in a condo association.
And one approach, and Mark was talking about baby steps before, one approach for baby steps is, these could be only lots, you know, it might be we think about steps, we do them on lots that face the street to start with and think about that approach.
Right.
I'm not sure what the baby steps are, but I'm sure there are some.
Well, and I was just thinking about that as far as you don't want the parking to be in front, so you don't want street parking. Right. So if you're going to have flag parking lots where all four units get to and from the street, you know.
Common driveway.
Yeah, a common driveway sort of begs the discussion there, because you're not going to own four driveways.
Right.
So I think there's some things to do. I'm kind of with Tess. I think it's a great idea. And I think that it's going to be tough to write it in a way that it gets us what we're envisioning.
And also, just to throw this out there, if we move forward with the other regs, that 2,000 to 5,000 is no longer a trigger for site plan. Mm-hmm. This would be an internal review by staff for potentially a 4,500 square foot four townhouse thing, which is totally unique, and maybe we think it's a good idea, but we'll never see it if it's under that threshold.
So this may be one of the baby steps. Well, I hate special permits because it scares everyone away. That could be a possible baby step. Maybe we do this first as a special permit.
Right.
Let's get a year or two under our belt, and then maybe we come back and have a conversation.
That might make sense.
But then, just to go back, the site plan would still be there and still be recorded. It just wouldn't be coming to the planning board at the administrative site plan level.
Right. No, I get that. Okay. But this is a new,
so new,
yeah,
new
frank.
Duck.
Yeah.
You know, it's
yeah.
new, and
it doesn't allow us to learn from what
right.
your process
right.
looks
yeah,
like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay.
That's great.
So as we push towards 9 o'clock, let's do wayfinding for active living.
So this is just a 30-second.
Who could argue against
that? Sounds like signage.
Yeah, who could argue against that?
So this is basically just an update, but also another place we're always looking
wayfinding
for input.
For
so, you know, we have this large $600,000 planning and public health grant. We're doing lots of different things with it. And it's a regional grant, although a lot of money is being spent in North Hampton. One piece of it is putting wayfinding signs, and you probably heard about this. Huh? So we have money to the idea is, how do we get some people to walk or bicycle instead of drive? And just making people realize the world is smaller than they think of it. So I live almost exactly a mile from here, and I drive more often than I should. If a sign in my street said it's an 18-minute walk downtown, with that, you know, maybe it's one trip a week, maybe occasionally convinces me I should walk instead of drive. So we have this grant we're putting in. If any of you use the bike path, we have 12 kiosks along the bike path. We're replacing the signs on all the kiosks with new, better graphic and more solid signs. We're working with PVTA to put in wayfinding signs on the 14 PVTA bus shelters. And we have money for about, I think, 80 metal signs. There'll be along fence posts and signposts in town. So one of the Smith College parking garage that says, free parking after 5, and then a sign in the garage that says it's a 10-minute walk to City Hall. So people go there and along the bike path. So that's just so you know this is going on. But the pitch is, we have, I think, about 20 signs we haven't identified yet. So if people have ideas, they a place that it might be useful, we have the money, we have the sign blanks. And
I think every one of our parking lots should have distance to downtown and just call downtown the main intersection or whatever. But in the same way, and I was thinking of this before you told me about Smith parking garage, but I think every parking lot ought to say 3-minute walk to the commercial district or
the main street or something.
Yeah.
Main street,
okay.
Where else would I like them?
It seems like you're trying, if you're trying to get people to walk where they ordinarily wouldn't, so you're moving outside of downtown, but outside of downtown there aren't parking lots other than Smith College. So the kind of signage, yeah, I don't know how, I don't know, other than, you know, 12-minute walk to downtown on 12 minutes way on Elm Street somewhere, wherever that is. Is that the type of thing you're looking for, or maybe at the Y, or, you know, people somewhere where, or the high school where people congregate, where there's a reason for them to be there, Child's Park or something, versus a random neighborhood at a 12-minute distance away that doesn't have any significance other than the fact that it's 12 minutes away.
Well, I'm thinking of dense housing like the on Jackson Street. What's the
yeah.
You know. Hampshire Heights.
Yeah.
Hampshire Heights.
Hampshire Heights we have. We have it covered. did meet with the Housing Authority today. They gave us permission to put signs on the property.
So. Do you have the new hotel?
What?
The new hotel?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
That's where I want to have my transit cooperative circulator bus, you know. Is it just signage or what? Would that be great, a transit cooperative circulator bus?
You know, I've worked so hard to get the circulator bus to town, and I just watch it go around empty, and it breaks my heart.
Two people
Wait, we have a circulator?
We do.
In Northampton?
Yeah.
And hop on.
I had no idea we had a circulator.
Yeah, it was what, a year ago? And we were working on getting it to River Valley Market and the Survival Center were the two that I was working with. And I really envisioned that it would really change things because I'm used to the...
Is it a little bus?
It's a midsize usually.
Huh.
But I'm used to the one in D.C. that is just packed. Yeah, and all it does is just run. I mean, it's highly used. So it's quit grinning.
is this just for signs or can this be for, like, this is just for physical, actual signs?
I don't know.
The thing on the asphalt or on the sidewalks, like chalk signage.
Yeah, we look really expensive.
Could you have a sign somewhere, whatever, near Child's Park that says, hey, there's a circulator bus that runs, does laps. You know, so maybe it's just a thing where people aren't aware of, they get in the car because they're not aware of a circulator bus. I mean, if you've been looking
at never knew there was a circulator.
Yeah. I mean, I just went to
school downtown.
Yeah.
You have, you know, yeah. From...
Right. What are you talking about?
Circulating.
Okay.
Okay. That's
any
great.
Other ideas? Going once, going twice. Bike ped plan.
So this
can
is
I ask one more question before we... Does this project have anything to do with the map that... I received a map from Terry Masterson this week about like a walking map. Okay, this is totally different.
Right.
Okay, just checking.
So I think we've talked about this plan before, right? Bike ped plan? So the same grant that we have, so we have multiple grants that are out there, but most of this is from this public health grant. So we have two contracts. We have a contract with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, who's really charged with trying to figure out how do we get low-income and populations who aren't typically part of the process to take part in our bicycle ped planning and hopefully take part in future planning cycles. So that's mostly just about directed outreach for low-income populations, minority populations, non-English-speaking populations. And so I think I'm hoping that'll be successful both for bike ped but also sort of to find more people. You know, the story I always tell, and this is now a very old story, but when we did the downtown plan years ago, we had all the high school. And we had a fairly diverse set of people, except age-wise. There was probably like no one under 30. And I always remember this woman who walked in, and she was like 21, and she looked around, and you could just see she was sizing up and said, nobody here looks like me. And she walked out. Mm-hmm. You know, and so that's part of the reason we're interested in this thing. How do we change some of that and get people on boards and all that sort of stuff. But the bigger part is we have a contract with Alta Planning and Design to do a comprehensive bicycle and pedestrian plan. We've never had that. We have pieces. Our open space recreation and multi-use trail plan talks about where we do future multi-use trails. Our comprehensive plan is a lot about sort of general transportation policies. We followed through. You guys endorsed this a few months ago. City Council, at the last meeting in December, adopted a new complete streets policy based on what you guys saw, I think, in August. So we have those elements, but it's not sort of deep into the weeds. And so they're going to be doing a few different things. They're going to be looking at Main Street and getting conceptual designs that thinks about if we drop a lane from Main Street, so it's one lane each direction, turn pockets, how do we use the extra real estate? You know, for example, do we want wider sidewalks? Do we want a tree belt? Do we want a cycle track along the curb? Do we want a cycle track down the center line of the road? They're all great, but we can only do like one of those things. So they're going to help, because it's really talking about 15 feet of pavement we might get free. So they're going to talk about that. That's the one that's deepest in the weeds. They're going to, because it's actually a regional grant, they're going to come up with a design manual for urban, suburban, and rural streets that might apply here. Some of you, when we did the subdivision regs last year, may have seen the manual we have, which is sort of a nationwide manual about streets. But it's sort of a generic manual. It doesn't worry about do you have snow removal or not. It doesn't have numbers. So it's basically taking this kind of manual that's out there and customizing it for us. Like Boston is an amazingly good manual, but They're not exactly like Boston. So how do we customize for that? And then just sort of looking through all of our crosswalks, we have like 208 crosswalks or something like that. All of our crosswalks, places where we have sidewalks, helping identify what should the priorities be for those things going forward, what should the design standards be, looking what DPW has, making recommendations. You approved the subdivision regs last year, and we think it's good, but we'd like a set of outside eyes to look at that and the zoning to say, well, you get an A minus, here's the changes you might want to think about for those things. And just sort of generally think about those sort of policies, how do we make those decisions going forward. It's a 9-month process, so it's somewhat compressed. There's going to be a public meeting in March, a public meeting in May. They're meeting monthly with our bike and ped subcommittee, which Ann is on. So it's sort of this mostly to give you a heads up. When we have definite dates, we'll send them out to you. We'd love to get you as involved as you're all willing to be. A lot of the recommendations will be coming back to you later, at least the regulatory ones coming back to you.
I mean, how do we, not reconcile, but over the years, we've had different third-party engineering firms look at, specifically downtown, the crosswalks, the vehicular traffic flows. We had that Notre Dame charrette however many years ago where they talked about, you got a lot of potentially wasted space here, bring in the sidewalks or add a tree belt or whatever. And so we're having independent studies done every 3 years. With this one, would they take some of that information that's already been, that we already have? Because we've had those, gets people excited, or gets people talking anyway, but then nothing happens.
Yeah.
Do it again and then do it.
But I wouldn't say nothing happens. These things take a long time to build on it. So if you remember, we had Nelson Nygaard a few years ago, and the city has since hired a consultant to look at King Street from Finn to North. It's building on some of those lessons. We did that same process for Main Street, and it did a couple other processes, as you say, and we're now looking at Cracker Barrel Alley, which is the alley across from City Hall. We're doing a title search, and the hope is to close the alley and put bollards up to make it safer. We did a preliminary design of the intersection of Main State North, that whole, or Main State New South Street. Yeah. And we realized, we got to a certain phase, and we realized it was a bigger project, and the mayor agreed to about $300,000 to design all of Main Street. But we didn't want to do that until we did this piece. So this is a 20-year process.
Right.
But it is definitely building on it. Main Street was repaved, or the sidewalks were done in 1985-ish. And they're beginning to show their wear. So one of the things we're talking about is redoing everything, but that's probably an $8 million project. So spending a couple $100,000 on conceptual is not... Yeah. But so yes, we are going there. We're very aware of the things. Notre Dame was the least scientific of those.
Right, right.
So it's more for ideas. But the other ones were very specific for doing it. So yeah.
Okay. At one point I had heard, and it was back when I was on transportation and parking, Ned gave a number of crosswalks at 600. I don't know if that, I'd love for somebody to tie that number down.
Okay,
but also, if it is not feasible, I don't want to give the DPW permission not to paint them all every year, but I think there could be some value in prioritizing the ones that must get painted every year. And I don't, that's just the only idea I have along that line.
So it's sort of making, keeping you in the loop and, you know, hoping you all get involved. Anne will be particularly involved, but the rest of you is involved if you want to be. So.
Okay.
Any other thoughts on bike ped? Moving on to climate adaptation update.
So this is, just to give you, keeping the loop and where we're going. So all this, remember, is, you know, we did Sustainable Northampton in 2008. It's sort of our Bible. We really do use this a lot for the work that we're doing. Our plan, unless you tell us not to, is... The plan, in theory, it's a 20-year plan, but it becomes less and less effective the further out we go. You've done a lot of things like the URB and URC zoning and about to work on the URA zoning. And so my hope is in 2018, when the plan's 10 years old, that we adopt a new plan. When we've looked at the plan, you've heard some of this before, we think the two weakest sections in here are bike and ped, which is why we're doing the bike and ped piece, and climate adaptation. So we're trying to give an equally big focus for climate adaptation. If you took part in our ESTAT in September, which was about climate adaptation, we commissioned a study based on a state grant we had on health effects of climate change. They did a presentation there. The final report's almost ready, so within a week or two, we should have the final report. And so that was our first piece about climate change, and thinking about that. We are in the process, the very early process, of doing a greenhouse gas emissions inventory. The mayor signed us up for Compact of Mayors, which is a pledge to do a climate mitigation plan. So we're moving forward on that piece. We approached Kleinfelder, who's a Cambridge firm. They're the firm the city's used to look at our sewage treatment plant. Have any of you read that in the paper recently? They did a vulnerability assessment for Cambridge, which is a wonderful document. We asked them to tell us what it would cost, and they said, well, about $100,000 for Northampton. You're a small city. So not surprisingly, we're not doing a vulnerability assessment outside consulting. So we've decided to do that in-house, which means it's a slower process. But so over the next year, staff-wise, we'd like to do the greenhouse gas emission. That's really just a staff effort. And the vulnerability assessment be staff-driven, but that's something that both the planning board and the community are very involved with. So by the end of, originally I'd hoped we might find money and do vulnerability assessment not in-house, and we do a climate adaptation plan in-house by the end of the year. If we're doing the vulnerability assessment in-house, that probably means that's the end of 2016, and then we're doing climate adaptation plan in 2017. But so that's what we're working on. So you're going to see pieces of this. It's not this stuff is earth-shattering. The city's been doing climate mitigation, reducing our greenhouse gas emission footprint for a long time. And we do lots of individual things. And the example I keep giving is, if you guys remember when you did the subdivision regs, you changed the kind of street trees that are required to trees that could survive in a warmer climate. So we do a lot of these things. The city has a $2 million grant, more or less, to do a microgrid up by between DPW and Cooley Dickinson Hospital and Smith Folk, which is our emergency shelter. So we're doing all of these things, but we've never really had an across-the-board framework. And so that's the piece we want to come back on, and sort of make sure we're thinking about all these things. And some will affect you in turn, we may want to change the subdivision regs in terms of stormwater standards, or the standards that we have now, right when we have bigger storms. We're trying to do, we don't have money yet, but we're trying to do this project on Pleasant Street, which would include tree box filters for trees, which might actually get some of the stormwater from the roads going into the tree boxes. So there's lots of those things that are out there, but the idea of this is to put it all. And again, nothing right now for action, but just want to keep you in the loop, and we'll come back as it goes forward.
Thank you. Any questions about that?
Actually, one last thing, just, so besides the complete streets ordinance, which City Council just passed, which has real teeth, it probably should free up about $50,000 in a state grant to do a complete streets transition plan, and then probably about $100,000 to do at least a pilot project to start the complete street. So going back to your comment, these plans do lead us somewhere in terms of money. And then we're going before City Council next week to do a green streets policy. It's not an ordinance, it's just sort of the beginning of discussion, but it's basically just to raise awareness and to say, yes, we want, some of these measures as part of each of our streets. DPW is doing a lot already, but to formalize it, sorry.
That's right. Okay. Two quick A&Rs?
I think so.
You've got us for a little while longer.
Okay. I'll be quick. This one is on Ryan Road. You guys actually approved a common driveway and flag lot, so this is just creating the flag lot. It's a truck. Whoops, go ahead, upside down. Yes. Just creating the actual flag lot that was approved as part of a special permit, but I still had to bring it before you. So that one, it's the same geometry as the permit that you reviewed.
Okay. All good?
Mm-hmm.
Do you need a vote?
Yes.
Motion. Mark, Bill seconded.
Okay.
All in favor? Unanimous.
Let's see. The other one is on Chesterfield Road.
The city in Chesterfield about?
Oh, it's what?
Wait, past Chesterfield.
You know where it splits where Montague Road cuts off?
Uh-huh.
About 100 yards beyond that, or maybe 100 feet beyond that.
And there's a little bridge there.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right. Okay. No, it's after the bridge.
It's after the bridge.
Yeah. This is way before that.
Okay.
This is before you even get to Reservoir Road. You want to help me hold that? Existing lots of frontage,
600 feet of frontage. There's an existing house, the idea is just cut the minimum lot size is 80,000 square feet and 175 feet of frontage, so it's creating a 175-foot frontage lot.
Is it where near where the solar array is at?
Yes, it's next to that one further west, couple west. Yeah.
Motion to approve A&R on Chesterfield Road.
Second.
Test Peter on that one. All in favor?
Okay. Last but not least, the minutes.
Yeah.
I move to approve the minutes of November 12th and December 10th.
Second.
Mark and Ann approve the set of minutes. Any comments, changes, corrections? All in favor? Unanimous. I think they're kind of wanting out of here. I would table the idea that we might go around and do our committees. It's longer meeting than I thought. But at some point, I would like to get us in a more regular habit of saying what the other committees are doing. It's a sort of report back into us.
Motion to adjourn?
By Tess. Seconded.
Second.
By Mark. This side of the table has to work harder next meeting. All in favor?
Kellen, do you have much coming up in 2 weeks?